don't know, but I've been told.
I don't know, but I've been told.
This recorder's mighty old.
This recorder's mighty old.
Testing 1, 2.
Testing 3, 4.
Testing 1, 2.
3, 4.
DC bias is the best.
DC bias is the best. Wait a minute. DC bias is the best? Where do you come up with that?
Because I have DC bias?
Well, okay, but just having it doesn't make it the best.
That's enough of that. This is an examination of the General Electric reel-to-reel 3-inch portable tape recorder from the 1960s.
But I'm the General.
Which insisted on telling me it's the General. It is the model number M-8000 machine. I do not know if it was made in the United States or Japan. It does not say where it was made. It uses little 3-inch reels. It has two speeds, 1 7/8 and 3 3/4. The marking on the head cover does not mean anything about the speed. You change speeds by just slipping off a capstan sleeve. Four functions: stop, record, play, rewind. Input for a microphone, remote, and output for an earphone. This is not a sound monitoring output, so when you're making a recording, this does not monitor. It has an input for a 6-volt DC power supply, and it runs on 4D batteries. I have to say that I'm kind of disappointed with this machine. I know of some General Electrics that have this same design from this time period, and I must have gotten confused when I saw this on eBay. This unit only has 3 transistors on the amplifier. The sound is pretty bad. I think one of the transistors in the recording circuit is going bad. It also has in no meter. Instead, there's a little flashing neon tube, which is an indication of cheapness, to be quite honest. The mechanical transport is very good. The microphone that comes with it sits in this little area right here when you wrap up the wire and everything. It is a crystal microphone, and you could hear it's not very good quality. So overall, this machine, I wouldn't say I was able to restore it. I was able to get it to function again. The problem that it had was the belts were gone on it. They'd simply stretched. But the machine was fairly well kept. I think that 40 years have just done it on the amplifier. I played with the capacitors. There's only 3 of them in the circuit, and playing with those didn't make any difference to the quality of the sound. It does make a good playback of a pre-recorded tape, and it does have fairly low wow and flutter, which I will show you in just a second. So we're going to listen to it play back. There's a switch that's supposed to cut off the rewind sound, but it is not functioning. Stop. Play. Now, that recording was made on the Panasonic RQ705. It obviously sounds considerably better on that machine. One of the funny characteristics about this machine is if I remove the head cover, you can see it has 2 electrical heads. If you just brush against any one of these buttons, it starts the machine. This is a defect in the design of the machine. The stop button doesn't have enough of a lockdown. I've gone inside, tried to adjust it. There's no adjustment to be made on it. And because of this, when I received the machine, there was a dimple in the pinch roller, which I had to sand out. Fortunately, that did not interfere with the wow and flutter of the machine. So it has good playback quality for speed, but it's hampered by this absolutely awful amplifier that's in it. It's a nice machine, it's an historical machine, but it's a disgrace that they put in such a bad amplifier. It has this little acrylic cover for it, and you can carry it around on a handle. That's pretty much it. We'll take a look at the inside next. This is the interior of the General Electric unit, and it shows the amplifier board, which is located here, the capstan flywheel, which is quite large, located here, the motor, the speaker is located here, and here is the little indicator for the level. It is not a meter, it is a neon light. The amplifier board shows no sign of an AC bias coil, and the sound does not indicate AC bias either. The record play switch is located here. This wire is blocking your view probably, and it switches, slides over for record and back for play. And I replaced the belt on the machine. The motor is a little bit noisy. I put a couple of little felt washers to try and keep the noise from the machine. When any of the functions are placed, the motor simply turns. When it's in rewind, the motor turns in the same direction. And when it's stopped, it stopped. When it's in record, this unit will move over. The interior of the General Electric is very simply laid out. It is built on a plastic deck, which is hardwired all throughout the machine, so it's a little hard to work on. I've got it just gently propped here. When the machine is put into the play mode, the capstan runs a spring belt, which drives the take-up table. The spring belt allows enough slippage so that there's no binding on the capstan. When it is put in rewind, this idler will press against the capstan neural shaft, very common to a lot of these machines, and through a belt will run the rewind table. Notice that at the same time the take-up reel is still spinning and it is still slipping. So this puts tension on the tape during rewind so that the tape winds a little bit more tightly than it would otherwise. Motor is located here. It is a electric governor controlled motor. There's no speed control for it. And the pinch roller is located here. I have the 3¾-inch capstan sleeve lifted off the unit right now. It slides down on the capstan sleeve and it has a screw base which allows it to lock on so it doesn't use an external knob.